States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Okay, we'll start with the consent items. We have the minutes of the August 22nd regular board meeting, the minutes of the August 22nd study session, and the minutes of the September 7th study session. Are there any additions or corrections? If not, entertain a motion to approve.
So moved.
Okay, motion by Jenny.
Second.
And second by Sandy. Any other discussion? All in favor? Okay, motion carries 0. Financial report. Bell?
So this evening we've got claims that from 10,004 to 10,158 on the docket. They total $1,071,917.36. We also have payrolls as well for there for August payrolls. For funds report for general fund, we're slowly gaining and growing from there. We had receipts of $999,743.76. Month-to-date expenses were $772,599.21. Leaves us with an ending balance of $632,002.20, and we were up a couple hundred thousand. We did start with $404,857.65. So gaining in momentum is growing, and goals are heading underway from there. So debt service fund, not really a lot going on. We started with $1,746,437.99. Had some PTRC tax credits of $8,663.44. That's $22 in expenses for a reporting to the state of Indiana for a yearly piece that was processed. So it left us with an ending balance of $1,755,079.43 for the debt service fund. Capital projects, we started with $1,186,943.87. We had, again, more PTRC money of $4,638.95. Expenses totaled $75,357.81 with an ending balance of $1,116,225.01. So pretty much status quo, nothing really a lot going on in comparison to other months, so, which is a reason rationale for the decrease in expenditures. Transportation fund, we started with $1,076,312.72. Had, again, more PTRC money of $8,923.50 for receipts. Our expenses totaled $29,199.84 with an ending balance of $1,056,036.38 for transportation fund. Last but not least, bus replacement fund. The buses that we've ordered haven't arrived yet, but they're in transit. So we have a beginning balance of $346,971.51. PTRC receipts of $536.73. Of course, no expenses. Ending balance leaves us $347,508.24. Any question on the fund report?
Any questions? Need a motion to approve the financial report?
So moved.
Okay, motion by Brad.
I'll second.
And second by Jenny. Any other discussion? All in favor? Motion carries 6-0. Is your hand up, Sandy?
Yes. Sorry. Yes.
Okay. All right. At this point in the meeting, we're going to recess the regular meeting and open our public hearing on the proposed budget for 2017.
As Scott pulls the PowerPoint up. This is pretty much an overview of what we discussed last month on the pre-warm-up session for the public hearing tonight. Since we've gone through the details, I've kept quite a few of them in place and summarized it for brevity. I can roll, thanks Scott. So recapping 16 budget updates. We do have the gateway, and just this afternoon I did make sure that gateway link is on our new website, and it's right there on the front page. So if you have any questions, finding it, or if any, if anybody brings those to you, just if you don't see it, just look a little closer. It's in one of those new icons on the new website. Form 3 is also accessible beginning with last year. And we've got bus replacement plan, and the CPF plan is advertised through the newspapers. They've already ran, but if you or anyone that you know would like to see a hard copy, they're available for view at our central office as well. Yes. 2007 budget updates. Ultimately, the goal of the DLGF and legislators was to pretty much in a nutshell get the budget process wrapped up in a more timely fashion. So through that process, then our local taxing units, such as the auditor and assessor and things like that, their timelines have changed to now be more proactive, where their pieces are due earlier, so then therefore our pieces are more accurate in reporting as well when it comes to knowing and understanding what our 2017 taxpayer budget levies will be and how much funds that we're receiving. For the next slide on the budget calendar, to recap, August 31st, we had our notice of public hearing appearing in Gateway, as well as the bus replacement and CPF plans. They did appear in Rochester Sentinel and the Shopper. Tonight we've got the public hearing. Next month on the 24th at the board meeting, we've got the budget adoption. And then November 2nd is when the CPF plan will run in the Sentinel and the Weekly Shopper. Here's another review of the balances. Again, we talked about this last month as well, but just how each of the funds have moved throughout the last 4 years of up and down and roundabout and things like that. So next slide has year-over-year assessed value increases and how that piece has increased over the last, actually over 15 to 16, it looks like it decreased, but really curious as to how that will look for 2017 as we get closer. On to the rainy day. We budget for the rainy day in the event that we need to use money out of the rainy day. So right now we have $119,417.78 in the rainy day. We don't anticipate adding to, but just in case, you don't have to have permission to add to, but at the same time you have to have permission to spend. So this is why we're advertising this piece in it. Again, don't anticipate adding to, so that is why the revenue does say zero, but we do have the expenditures in there for the appropriations in case we need to use them next year. History of General Fund through the state's tuition support. So it's like we grew in 14-15 and then we're down at 15-16. So official count day was last Friday. So very, very closely watching the numbers to see how that comes in for the 16-17 school year. And as soon as we know more, we'll share that as well. Projected revenues are $15,210,630. So that's not just the basic grant, but that's other grants that we get as well, in even addition to the other pieces of that include running facilities and those types of aspects of general fund. So total revenues is a little over $15 million. And then from there we go. I did keep this part of the detail intact in case any questions arose that weren't addressed at the last budget discussion. Here's our projected expenditures, and then the next slide sums it up of $15,331,207 for general fund projected expenditures. So finalizing pieces, we've got corporation contribution to health insurance plans are fixed up at the same time when that's also a moving part as well, you know, in an effort to grow the health insurance fund. So that'll be watched closely as well, and making sure that, that we're fiscally responsible overall. Debt service fund, projected revenues are $3,389,489. So that's, of course, through the tax revenues and levies from there, as well as the PTOC, which is property tax relief credit that we get. Expenditures total $3,431,970 for our various bonds, between bonds and QSB bonds, and then our fees that we have ongoing as well. Capital projects fund anticipated revenues are $1,727,260. Of course, tax levy revenue in there, as well as the other, some of the facility rental goes in this piece, as well as when devices are need repaired and things like that, so that gets paid for out of CPF, and then when they get fixed, if we, you know, when we receive revenue in from the repair of those devices, it gets received in there. So capital projects fund, projected expenditures on this page is $1,900,000, going through the gamut of that. Transportation fund, projected revenues come up to $794,866. We've got tax levies, PTRC, and some other funds from there. Expenditures total $900,000 between keeping the buses running and on the road, keeping them all the fuel in them that they need, as well as paying for bus drivers and overall operation supplies and insurance. Last but not least, bus replacement fund. Projected revenues are $268,018 through taxes. And then expenditures is $360,000 for buying more buses in 2017 to replace our fleet that is continually updated and needs replaced. So the next step of the 2017 budget process is the budget adoption on the 24th next month. And then from there, we'll not only adopt the budget on the 24th, but also the CPF and bus replacement plan. And then the CPF adopted plan will appear in the Sentinel and the Shopper. Are there any questions? All right, thanks so much for your time.
Okay, thank you, Val. A lot of work goes into that. Didn't have any other questions from the board? Okay. If not, we'll adjourn the hearing on the proposed budget and resume our regular board meeting. We're going to make a little change in our agenda. We're going to move up the Safe Routes Committee at this time. So, Terry?
Charlie, you do have pull. Should I just speak from back here, or how do you like it?
Come on up.
Ted's waving me, so I'm going to follow that lead. Okay, for a couple of years, we've been working on Safe Routes to School. It's an Indiana Department of Transportation program that I passed out a little binder to everyone. If you want to flip with me to page 1-2, the program objectives are to encourage and enable children, including those with disabilities, to walk and bicycle to school. Number two, to make bicycling and walking to school safer and more appealing transportation alternative, thereby encouraging a healthy and active lifestyle from an early age. And also to facilitate the planning, development, and implementation of projects and activities that will improve safety and reduce traffic, fuel consumption, and air pollution in the vicinity of schools. We have already taken surveys from parents. If you flip to the back of the handout there, you'll see, if you have your magnifying glass, the results of the surveys from the parents. Most of the concerns were traffic safety, fear of crime, or personal safety, lack of sidewalks, curb ramps, crosswalks, and poor lighting. So what we have the ability to do through the NDOT program is a couple of things. One is non-infrastructure, and that's really the phase that we're in now. So that's encouragement and education and enforcement. The Safe Routes to School Committee is consists of Casey Coles with the Fulton County Plan Director's Office, Shada Beeler, the city clerk, Betsy Hines with Purdue University. Wave to everybody, Betsy. Scott, you guys know Scott. Andy Schatz, police chief. Charlie Schwenk, everybody knows Charlie, and then myself. So what we've been working to put together in the last month or so, or a little bit longer, is part of the encouragement phase. We'd like to get permission to schedule an October 4th walk to school day, October 4th. We're gonna start out with Riddle. Now the Safe Routes to School program is middle and elementary school, not high school. It's within 2 miles, 2 mile radius of those schools. We wanted to bite off a small piece of the elephant at once and start with Riddle, have the walk to school day on October 4th. Our plan right now is based on preliminary data and research and observations. It looks like we have a number of kids walking down Fulton Avenue to Riddle and then using 4th Street and or 3rd Street to get into the school. So we're gonna have an officer at three locations, Fulton and 6th Street, Fulton and 4th, and then also 3rd and Pontiac. Betsy, thank you. And then also at each one of those locations, we'll have at least one of the Safe Routes to School committee members. So we'll talk to the kids that will listen and talk over the kids that don't listen and just talk to them about safety and getting to school walking, how to look out for each other, different things like that. We're hoping to also engage parents on that day, so we're encouraging parents to come out, walk to school with their kids. Our plan is to meet by 7:15 and then leave from the 6th and Fulton and the 3rd and Pontiac locations and come over to 4th Street where Luke will be waiting to then walk kids in kind of together. So we're hoping to have, I think in some of our preliminary counts we had, Shirley?
22
walkers. Kids walking, and how many kids on bikes?
We had 9 bikes, and then one day we had up to 12 bikes.
Okay, so 30 to 35 kids right now. We hope on this day we can bring out 50. And then what we want to do, hopefully parents will turn out, is look for volunteers that will help in the future, parent volunteers that might be part of what's called a walking school bus. Charlie has more information about that. I think you're attending a...
I'm going to go to a meeting September 28th to find out more and hopefully bring back some good information for our schools.
Yeah. So we'll be looking for parents that would like to step up and maybe help the kids get to school safely, maybe invite more kids to come out and walk or bike to school. And let's see, from there, I think on that day we'll be, we've got some handouts about the program. I think we're looking to get some stickers, like the I Walk to School Day sticker. We may even start a program where kids get points for walking each day. And then some awards or rewards for that eventually. Now this is the non-infrastructure piece, but looking forward to the infrastructure piece, and kind of how this works is the city has actually served as the applicant for the grant. We've already received the grant for pay for things like educational materials, stickers, helmets, reflective gear for cross walks, traffic control signals, things like signs, things like that. And then as we go through additional evaluation and we make sure we have the routes pretty much down that the kids are using mostly, we can go forward with an infrastructure grant application. Again, the city would be the applicant, and that might lead to sidewalk repairs or replacements, better lighting, curb ramps, different like actual infrastructure pieces in the city around the schools that would make it safer for kids to go to walk or bike to school. So, Betsy, Charlie, you guys have anything you want to?
Did you want to pass some of these around? We made a little flyer about it. There's only 5 of them. If you just want to pass them around.
So this is the flyer we're going to get to Mr. Bernicki. Bernicki, to get to the, if, with your permission, to get to the students at Riddle. As soon as we can get it out to them, and then hopefully get it to the parents also about the October 4th Walk to School Day. We also have some information that just kind of describes, this is what we're going to pass out on the day of. And then we'll report back to you guys how many kids participated. Mr. Bernanke possibly can do that. And then one of the things we'll be looking maybe to the school board, to the school corporation to do is, you know, confirm routes, be a voice for the program, perhaps down the line to the city council, if this is something that the school board is, you know, interested in helping us develop and push throughout the city, so we can encourage kids to walk and also identify safe routes. That's part of the project is, right now there's concerns about public safety or safety of the kids, a couple different reasons for that, I guess. So if you have routes that are identified, well-marked, well-lit, good infrastructure, then it is truly a safe route to school, and that's kind of where we want to be. We're going to be keeping track of, throughout the year, the number of kids that are walking and biking. We have a goal of, I forget what it is, to show that our program is increasing the number of kids getting to school through alternative transportation, and that will help lead us into the actual infrastructure grant possibility down the road, if that's something the school is interested in sort of partnering with us on. I guess we need kind of your go-ahead to do something October 4th, and we'd love to have any feedback that you might have.
A question on the infrastructure grant, that money would be targeted just for those routes, right? So
yes.
Any improvements?
Yes. I mean, it's got to be within two miles of the school. It has to be the middle school. Unfortunately, we really have the middle and the high school at the same campus, so we might be able to flex that a little bit. And the elementary school, so elementary and middle schools, but yes, it has to be within the 2 mile radius of the schools, which is practically the whole city for all intents and purposes.
Terry, I remember when that survey was done a couple of years ago, and there are obviously infrastructure issues, some places that are near schools that don't even have sidewalks or broken sidewalks, that kind of thing. But one of the things that really came up that I remember were concerned about this, the adults who may be around those routes. So is that part of looking at the safe routes, looking registered sex offenders, etc.?
Definitely. And Andy's preparing what we ask Andy Schatz, Chief Schatz, to prepare for us is basically a radius map, you know, with little, you know, pins on it, so we know, forearmed is forewarned, I guess. Forearmed is forearmed, how's that go? Anyway. But yeah, that's one of our concerns, and that came out in the parent surveys, that was a concern that kids might be going. And I forget what the radius is, that it's a very small radius or very small distance, in my opinion, how far away from the school that's allowed or not allowed. So I'm sure we'll see some of that.
1,000 feet.
What's that?
1,000 feet radius for a
sex offender.
Yes,
1,000 feet.
Okay. So we're also working to find ways that our students who go to Country Meadows that attend middle school and high school, for them to be able to safely cross 14. There are several options that we're looking into that we would like to make it an easier option for them to walk.
And one of the things we requested from NDOT 2 years ago was completion of crosswalks at a couple of locations. One was at Park Road on 14, one's at 14 at the intersection with 25, one's on Main Street at 15th Street, one's at Main Street, I think 12th Street. And those have all, I mean, they were done in 2014 and they've all worn through. We contacted NDOT 2 weeks ago, actually last week, I think, and they said we were on the list. We were behind some other cities, but that they hoped they would get those. They planned to get to those this year. Before they put the trucks away for the winter. So at least we'll have those fortified here pretty soon. And if there are other locations, really their only requirement in crossing a state road with a crosswalk is that there be a request for it and that there be a sidewalk on both sides of the state road. Not just one side, there has to be a sidewalk on both sides. So we're going to stay on them about that and keep those, you know, keep, make sure that stays on their radar to keep those done. And then I know that doesn't answer the question of kids coming down, walking down State Road 14 from Country Meadows, but, you know, perhaps that's part of the infrastructure grant later on.
Any other questions? I think it's a great idea. Chris, the board support?
Motion. A motion to support the project.
Accept the motion to support the project for the Safe School Routes.
So moved.
Okay, motion by Brad.
I second that.
And a second by Steve. Any discussion? All in favor?
I would like to ask just one question. What, you have all these safety things in place for students who live close to Riddle. What about the ones on the other side of town? I mean, are you encouraging those kids to walk to school too?
Well, you get a little slippery on the slope there when you have kids walking from, you know,
Columbia.
Yeah, from, say, the Columbia area over to middle school. I'm not sure our data really showed elementary school kids walking that far.
So you're not really encouraging that necessarily?
No. Crossing State Road 25, 14 for a Riddle school, you know, we're not encouraging that.
Okay.
At all, but we know we have a good number of
right.
middle and high school kids that are crossing 25 and 14. The only probably safe place to do that would be, you know, at the intersection of 9th Street and Main Street. But even there, it's kind of tricky, you know, turning traffic and so forth. But it's really more for, based on the way we're set up, it's especially for Riddle, really just kids on this side of Main Street for concentration. Now, if we see there's a need on the east side and we have, you know, parent volunteers or school volunteers or a crosswalk guard, then maybe that's something we can look at it as we're doing the walk to school and other parts of, you know, encouragement evaluation. If we see that there's just a lot of kids that would walk or bike if there was a safe route, yeah, that's something we can work toward.
Okay.
As long as we document it and can show to NDOT that this is a need for us, then it would be open. But we'd have to agree that that's what we want to encourage.
We don't have a guard there at like the Napa store anymore, do we?
No. Now, the grant we have already, and we have a grant, I think, of $40,000 we have. That could pay for some things like crosswalk markings or training for crosswalk guards. I don't think it will actually like pay a salary for a crosswalk guard. I think the city actually has something in their budget for that. I'm not sure if that's in their 16 budget. It would have to be appropriated for 17, and we may already be around the bend on that too.
Well, we used to have one there, and then there was another one down at 4th Street, 4th and Main, 100 years ago.
4th Street is one of our, one of the streets that we think is pretty key. We think there's, right. We see a lot of kids on 4th Street, like Lucas Street. Mm-hmm. I think most of those are waiting on a bus pickup, though, mm-hmm. but it's a dark area, especially during the winter time. So lighting in that area while kids are just out on the sidewalks, if you're up and out there early, you know, it's tough to see the kids in that area. So that's another thing we'll be looking at, lighting placement.
Sounds like a good plan.
Thanks.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. All in favor? Okay, motion carries 6-0. Thank you, Terry.
Thank you.
Okay. Next item, donations. Okay, first one, Rochester New Holland, use of utility vehicle for the RHS versus Plymouth football game. Rotary Club, Columbia Students in Need of Shoes, 17 pairs of shoes. We have an anonymous donation, the RMS PBEIS Reward Program, Boys Bike and Helmet. Rochester Kiwanis Club, the RHS Key Club, $200. And Judith Wallace, Joanna Johnson, Kim Bill, Alicia Hoppus Classroom, several boxes of construction paper. Are there any other ones?
Not that I remember. I always look to Candy. She's always so good at that.
Okay, we need a motion to approve the donations.
So moved.
Okay, a motion by Jenny.
I second that.
And a second by Steve. Any other discussion? All in favor? Okay, motion carries 6-0. Once again, thank you for all the donations. Next item is overnight field trips.
Justin Pearson has submitted the FFA. There are three different field trips. One is the state soil judging contest in Marshall County. The other, and I don't know, is that one overnight? I don't believe that one is. The Marshall County one. I think it's the two Indianapolis, and the one to Indianapolis and the one to Trafalgar would be the overnight. And those are standard field trips that he takes, which really helps with leadership skills, knowledge, project-based learning, those types of components that we're really striving for. And to my knowledge, we've never had any concerns with his field trips and the way that those have taken place.
Okay, any questions? If not, we need a motion to approve the field trips.
So moved.
Okay, a motion by Jenny.
Second.
And second by Sandy. Enter the discussion?
Yeah.
Todd?
I noticed on one of the field trips, the FFA to the National in Indianapolis. Which staff members in charge? Of course, Justin. What other staff members will be going? None. Is that just what staff members are? Okay, no staff members, but does that mean there are no other adults going?
He does say on number 7 that he will likely take one additional female chaperone.
Okay, all right.
I don't know if there'll be more than that. Looks like it's 8 to 9 students.
And I know from the past that they also try to link with other FFA teachers from other districts and make sure that all of those components are covered. So sometimes they're sharing those supervision duties once they arrive there as far as the overnight components of it.
So depending on 8 to 9, are there females that would trigger the number 7?
Correct.
Correct. Okay, any other questions? We have a motion and a second. All in favor? Okay, motion carries 6-0. Okay, information analysis, approval of the 2017-18 calendar.
I hope that I have plenty of copies for everybody. These are stacked so that if you'd like to take some, I ran off copies. Let me get all my other stuff out. Let me hand some of these out. I had been working with the association and with the administrative team. As secretaries, I know principals were communicating, and we thought this morning, that's one set. One is a plain set, and then the other is copy B, and I've got extra. We thought we had it going well, and on Friday there were a couple ideas. You guys are laughing at me. And then you magically put out this all call, last chance, speak now or forever, hold your peace. And suddenly you get numerous other ideas and thoughts that go into this. So in an effort to consider all ideas, they're in sets like this, so if you can do an A and B, there should be enough to go around. So the one without the bee on top, so just the plain one and it's coming around, is the one that we have spent the most time looking at and talking about and considering. And in that, it continues to maintain the three-day fall break. We would have organizational day on August 1st. Opening day for students would be August 2nd. After speaking with the board in the study session around Christmas break, it was brought to our attention that some businesses actually close, and so we were trying to better correlate the closing of those, closing of our days with some of the local businesses to help with childcare. So with that in mind, we had backed up the start of Christmas break to December 20th, and then bringing students back on January 2nd to start second semester. One of the other components or considerations that we made is when I had first started with the calendar, we were looking at February 8th as a makeup day, but then it was brought to my attention that maybe we could do February 19th, which coincides with President's Day, and then if we don't have to utilize that day, families may have that three-day break together with many businesses closing on President's Day, so we were trying to honor that. We had looked at, and within trying to balance the calendar as best we could, trying to move spring break up earlier. There were just so many conflicts around some of the fine arts programs that happened during that time, athletics that happened during that time, that keeping those status quo, and we also, I believe that correlates with Good Friday, possibly. Mm-hmm. And then with this first calendar, students would be done with makeup days, barring no major weather concerns, May 25th. And it was always my understanding, and please, I want everybody to voice in, that we did our best to try to start school in August and get students out right around Memorial Day so that we did not carry those into June. So this is the one I'm most confident in the respect that it's been communicated to principals. We've had a lot of time to look at it and a lot of considerations around it. Option B is something that I just started working on this morning after RCTA voiced in and had a couple of concerns and ideas that they wanted to share. So they are proposing, they would like to start school later in August, so organizational day starting on August 7th, with the first student day starting August 8th. That would push the ending date, and again, I would like, if we're looking at calendar B, I feel I need to go back and have some further discussions with everybody because this is thrown together late, but I think if I've calculated the days right, that would push us back to ending school on June 1st, provided that we don't have any weather. If we have a lot of inclement weather, it could be later than that based on those e-learning days and those types of things. We would keep fall break where it originally was placed. The teachers have shared, Clint has been very open about the concern that teachers want the full 2 weeks off at Christmas break. Rather than on the first calendar I presented actually allows for 14 days, or I'm sorry, 14 total days, but 8 days of break time, 9 days of break time. Wait, let me,
9 days.
9 days, thank you, 9 days. And they are really pushing for the complete 2 weeks off. So in order to do that very quickly, that was the suggested to have faculty and staff and students in through the 22nd, which I am a little bit concerned about around Christmas holiday and travel and those types of components. But that would give them the full 10 days that they're requesting. I just want to be honest and upfront. Keeping our makeup day around President's Day, it allows us to keep spring break where we are, but the balance, I was a little concerned about the balance, and that was another reason they wanted to push Christmas break back, because the other concern is, even though first semester is not completely balanced for those who have been at the high school, if we don't push break back, they would be looking at exams after you return from Christmas break, and that has always created problems and concerns, and Candy's nodding her head. So to get around that, we would have to push that back. So I just feel like in good faith, I wanted to share that that was out there. If the board or anybody sitting there has ideas or is leaning towards Calendar B, I would appreciate the opportunity to really go back and dissect this deeper than just Val and I were in negotiations for about 4 hours today. So this is just communicating with emails back and forth, and I have reservations about Calendar B.
So you're saying it would be okay if we were to table this, study it at the study session, give public input, not necessarily a survey, because 40% will like it, 40% won't, 20% won't care. For whoever answers. And then we can vote on it in October, and it doesn't hurt the calendar or the adoption at all for us, correct?
It doesn't hurt the adoption. The only thing it does is delay families and community members who may be waiting on the calendar to be able to schedule with their own employers or family vacations, those types of things that we're trying to honor as well.
But still, we'd have it for them a year out.
Correct. We could have it in October. I just haven't had a chance to dissect Calendar B. I have some reservations.
I guess my one opinion out of seven or six of us is we table it and look closer.
If the administrative team and Candy, as a head secretary, I know you guys pick up on things that we often overlook, especially when we only put half an hour, 40 minutes into a Calendar B as opposed to hours into the first one.
I have a question. So when is graduation?
Well, I would have to work with Adam to push that back, but you would be looking at if June 1st is the last day traditionally, and that's with no weather, no problems, you would be looking at graduation at least, in my opinion, June 8th or possibly the 15th.
With B.
I mean, Candy's been there, Jason's been there. I mean, if June 1st is absolutely the last day, that's no inclement weather, and you can't, it's problematic to bring kids back after they have walked through the ceremony for exams. We experienced that 1 year. Candy's nodding her head when we were over there together. So you would be pushing graduation back to the 8th, possibly the 15th.
I would suggest that while I don't necessarily have a problem ending in June or starting a little later in August, I don't think that this is the time to do that for this following school year. In other words, it would be my preference that we had a calendar at least a year or two out. I think that what you've presented with the original balances it as much as possible. We have, by my count, 89 days in the first semester, 91 in the second. You don't get, I mean, there's only one day, obviously, flipping that. I see 9 days off for 9 work days off for Christmas break, starting with the first day as the 20th, so several days before actual Christmas. Thanksgiving, having that Wednesday off has been something that has been called upon and that overall people seem to enjoy. That's retained. We've kept a fall break similar to this fall break, so people who, I have already had people asking me about this, setting their vacations. And so there are some who have done that. Full disclosure, I haven't. It's not. I have a personal dog in there. Yes, it would be nice to start after the first week and in August, especially I think it's always nice to have a chance to visit the state fair. And this would be, again, another year where we're in school before it even starts. But if that's something that we want to rally community support behind, or we have something to change the trajectory of our calendar, then we should start working on 2018, 2019 now. But to give stability for next year and say, let's go with this option. I personally am not in favor of tabling and working more.
I'm not either. I agree with Jenny. I think for now we need to go with this one and then work on the 18-19 immediately, as it were.
I think that's my directive.
I guess my concern too is going after Memorial Day, how much quality education will take place. Most people will be tuned out, I would think.
Some say they tune out after spring break, which is another reason they kind of wanted it pushed a little further back there as well. The dynamic does change. The weather breaks, you can sense it in the buildings. I would agree with you.
I think the gain of starting August 7th versus the 1st doesn't outweigh the cost of going to school later into June. It just doesn't, it doesn't balance out. And, you know, that's summer, a week later, and some going to get summer jobs, getting out there, especially for the seniors.
And there has been a tremendous amount of time spent on this, the original.
I can just throw in my two cents too. It used to be, when we first went to this, it used to be hard to get records. Nobody was open, or new students coming in didn't know you were starting. This year, several area schools actually started a couple days before us. And I kind of feel like we're taking a step backwards as far as, and I know it's not necessary to match their schedules, but for getting records and new students coming in and being used to their school calendar, it does make a difference to those parents and what they're getting used to around the general area is starting the 1st of August.
Thank you. The administrative team, I believe, is comfortable with the original proposed. That's what we've had the most time to dissect and fill.
You said there were 4 hours you spent today. Was it all on this?
No. 4 hours in negotiations. This calendar B just came to me at like 8 o'clock this morning, and so I tried to throw together, based on what I was hearing, as quickly as I could. Calendar B has about 40 minutes of my time in preparation, so not a lot. I sent it out as soon as I got it, hoping for any feedback, and the feedback I got was kind of what we've talked about, the reason we spent so much time on it was to make sure that we got it right for everybody across the district and the community, and so.
Was this August 7th start, was that in any way tied in any way to the negotiations?
No, not at all.
Okay.
No, not at all.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, any other questions?
I didn't think so.
Looks like we have two options here. Accept the original calendar or table until we get more information on calendar B and more input. So I'll leave that to the board. Someone would like to make a motion on one or the other.
I move that we accept the original, let's call it option A, since it doesn't have a B on it.
Okay.
I second that.
Okay. Motion by Jenny and second by Sandy. The original calendar, we'll call option A, or calendar A. Any other discussion? All in favor? Okay, motion carried 6-0. Thank you. All work goes into a calendar then.
It does. I think sometimes people forget that you're working around state test days, you're working around making sure you have the instruction to support those state mandated tests. Whether we want to admit it or not, you're working around IHSAA and their calendars and those events. And so it goes much deeper than just trying to calculate 180 days and trying to balance that out. So we'll appreciate being able to go ahead and start planning and moving forward in that respect. And I'll start working on 18-19, as odd as that seems.
It really helps people with planning, and I appreciate that. Thank you.
That makes sense. That's a well thought out argument.
I thought one time we had talked about doing 2 years out. I'm just saying. Sorry.
I'm hearing you.
I grew up with somebody that likes that kind of thing, and so he would suggest that there's only, what, 6 different ways that it all can fall, that you just make out those 6 calendars, and that's how it happens every other time.
Okay.
I'm interested in talking to him and hiring him.
Yeah, he'd probably do it for free.
Next item is approval of the data sharing agreement.
The data sharing agreement actually came into being, and Jason will have some information too, I believe, in regards to readiness and ECA testing. That began several years ago when Dan Ronk was the superintendent, and I want to acknowledge him in this, and that he had the foresight to try to maintain local control in regards to teacher data as it relates to evaluations and how we have to fit that model for raises and everything. You have to have accountability with student growth and achievement. So in that, several years ago, we entered a consortium for those areas that are not tested The state requires that we test the math and the English at different levels, social studies and science. So this is for all of those non-tested areas as far as fine arts and those singleton classes, as we call them, for one semester classes. We've been doing that for several years now, probably 5, 6, maybe 7 years. And just recently, other schools have acknowledged that this may be the path to go. It started with a small consortium, and now we're picking up schools as far as Goshen, Westville, Hanover, Martinsville, Mishawaka are all starting to look at this as a component of their teacher evaluation methods. In that, we want to make sure that we have the reliability and validity that we need and that the state is now asking for as more schools are coming on board. So what we're asking is for the data sharing agreement to be signed so that for 1 year we can release the data, not by teacher, not by student, but the school data with all of those involved in the consortium to produce so that they can analyze the methods that we're using and the data and make sure that we have that validity and reliability that we need to continue to move forward and answer those state questions and teacher questions as well.
Okay, anybody have any questions on it? We've gone over this in the study session, a lot of the details.
I have a question.
Sure, Doug.
If there would come a time where we wanted to not participate in this, I don't know what that would be. How difficult would it be to get out?
The data sharing agreement is just a 1 year agreement, but to get out of the consortium is very easy. We just have to write the letter of notification and say that we no longer want to participate. But in that, we would lose, I think, a lot of valuable time and investment that we have in the process overall.
I was just curious because other things we wanted to not be part of have taken a long time and cost.
Now, because we're the core, we were one of the core groups to start this, we have some ownership in the direction that it goes. So.
Okay. Any other questions? Now we'll need a motion to approve the data sharing agreement.
So moved.
Okay, Jenny.
Second.
And second by Sandy. Any discussion? All in favor? Motion carried 6-0. Okay, first readings of several policies.
Yes, we have several policies that come to us twice a year. This group is affectionately known as 27-2. And the ones that we are presenting tonight are policies that our organization NEOLA has recommended changes. These, some are just a correcting of word, of different terminology. Some we just pretty much have to approve because it just aligns strictly with state law. So these aren't ones that have required lots and lots of discussion, but of course they are available for review if anyone would like to see them. We have policy 130 and 131.1, talking about our policies are published rather than printed, because of course many of them now are online, and that anything inconsistent with the law, where law would supersede policy. Policy 1130, conflict of interest. There are several of these conflict of interest ones because we have different sections of our policy. Some deal with professional staff, some deal with support staff, some with students and so on. So these numbers will come up again and again. But in general, it's that our staff members may not accept a gift or gratuity having substantial value or which will influence the interest in a decision to be made. That's also in 1214 and 3113. 3214 is another conflict of interest one. This one relates to professional staff. 3410 is a deletion because it's embedded in another policy. 4113, again, is another conflict of interest. 4140, termination and resignation. This one speaks more specifically that retirement and resignation, for our purposes, are the same thing. States the board will follow the law, yes, in regards to termination. 4214 follows 4113. This is about gifts, but this one is specific to support staff. 5610, suspension and expulsion of students. We are taking out the word deadly as it relates to weapon, and just read weapon. We also, as is consistent with many of our other policies, using the word may instead of shall. We trust our administrators and I'd like to give them some discretion. That one also, I remember correctly, well, my other cheat sheet, related to, oh, that's 5610.02 instead of just 5610. In-school discipline. If we have an in-school discipline program, it will be offered to students regardless of whether they have a disability or not. And 8500 is food services, that we will comply with federal guidelines while considering the individual needs of students in the district as far as dietary restriction, allergies, and so on. So I would ask that this would count as the first reading of those policies.
Okay. Thank you, Jenny. Any questions? Helen.
If you said this, I apologize. Is this on our website already?
Do we have these? I don't think we have them uploaded
yet. Not yet. I've got these.
Right. But we're planning on that.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Good. Any other questions? If not, I'll accept the motion to approve first readings of policies 130, 1130, 1214, 3113, 3214, 3410, 4113, 4140, 4214, 5610, 5610.02, and 8500.
I move that we accept the readings of these policies.
Okay. Motion by Steve.
Second.
And second by Brad. Any discussion? All in favor? Okay. Motion carries.
And so that it's made public, you have your homework assignment for the next board meeting.
Ones that
are not on the cheat sheet.
Now we're going to have to be held accountable.
Yeah. I gave him a cheat sheet for this one, but for the next one, there's some homework that was assigned.
Thank you, Jenny.
Was there a due date on that?
Yeah, by the next study session.
Okay. Personnel report. Okay, hiring. Kathleen Davis, Columbia one-on-one special needs instructional assistant. Resignation, Tanya Randall, RHS building tech. RHS extracurricular recommendation, Vinny Wang, Chinese club. Fall intercession, Felix Amandi, RHS English. Deb Wolford, RHS math. Chris Cox, middle. Ken Hughes, middle. Kylie Day, Columbia Kindergarten. Bethany Sewell, Columbia First Grade, will teach 2 days. And Megan Gongwer, Columbia First Grade, will teach 2 days. Amy Banks, Columbia Second Grade. Amy Freeman, Columbia Instructional Assistant. And sports coaching recommendation, Christina Hartrip, Assistant Swimming Diving Coach. And Allison Butler, JV softball coach. Any other late additions?
Tom, I don't have an addition, but I just had a change that just came through on the Bethany Sewell. Basically, the change would be Megan Gongwer would take all 4 of those days, and Bethany Sewell would not be included in that. And it was a choice that she had made based on some plans that had come up, so nothing major. But if you want to recognize that, leave it as is. Megan will take all 4 days.
Okay.
So I just wanted you to be aware.
They were going to share the 4 days, and now Megan will take all of them.
Yes, sir.
So Bethany will be off the list.
Correct.
Okay. With that correction, I need a motion to approve the personnel report.
So moved. With the correction.
Okay. Motion by Don.
I'll second that.
Second by Steve. Any other discussion? All in favor? Okay, motion carried, 6-0. Thanks, Jason.
Thank you.
Okay, the bus driver incentive proposal.
Valerie and I have been working with the transportation department, and there is a real concern in regards to the number of bus drivers we have, and as we continue to add more students to the district as well as to the routes, it's becoming very problematic to get drivers to Not, this is not unique to Rochester, it's happening throughout the state, and that it's difficult to find bus drivers. And so I asked the transportation department to do two things. One, to talk with others to see what the hesitancy is in going through the steps to become a bus driver, and then secondly, what other school districts are doing to try to encourage people to come on board as bus drivers. And so what you're seeing here is the all of that information compiled into one place. We are finding that oftentimes paying for the physical, paying for the testing fees, all of those types of things are very problematic to pay for, and then know that they're not going to be reimbursed and you just go into the job. So what we are proposing in the transportation account is, or fund, is very healthy and could definitely support this, is we are talking at about a $300 sign-on bonus. However, the first installment would not come to the new employee until after they have put in 3 months of employment. And then the second of that $300 sign-on bonus would come after 6 months of employment. At that six-month mark, we would also propose reimbursing them for their CDL physical, which runs between $100 and $140, so we just estimated that at the 120, and reimburse them for the state bus skills test, which is approximately $100. Another thing that I found is, I talked with transportation, is that there are 40 hours of training that's required by the state, and in the past we have not paid drivers for that training. So we would propose paying them the $9 per hour as they complete that 40 hours of training to become certified and licensed to drive buses. And again, this is very comparable or comparable to other districts, as well as having talked to those people who are interested, and then after they come in and they start asking questions, we find out the reasons that they're hesitant to continue to move forward. So we're hoping that this would address all of those questions and concerns that are being brought to us.
For our current bus drivers, if they have to get a CDL physical in the future and whenever they renew, will we cover that for our current employees?
I would agree that we could do that, but I don't know why they would have to.
I mean, I agree with keeping with the new hires, but let's think about our people who have been here a while too.
Sure.
And then the state bus skills test fee, is that a one-time deal, or is that,
correct,
do they do that every 3 or 4 years?
Not to my knowledge. But I would honor that for you. I agree.
Well, I'm not trying to put you on the spot now. I just want
no,
to
know. No, I understand.
So we're talking about like a $500 investment.
With that investment not coming until they have put in 6 months of employment here at Rochester. The 150, there would be 150 that would come after 3 months, and then the remainder would come after the 6 months.
Right now, we already do pay for the physical, reimburse for the physical.
We do.
We do that already.
For the CDL physical?
Mm-hmm. I had one come across my desk today.
I wonder why they haven't. Thank you, Julie.
Is that just with our current ones that we reimburse right now? It's just the current ones when they redo that? So
this would be for the new.
Correct.
So this would still be, okay. So that kind of answers your question.
Absolutely.
So this would be an adjustment to the policy and bus driver's manual.
Correct.
It does require board action.
Okay. Any other questions?
Does this require separate meetings?
It does, but you can if everybody can
jump all over.
That's all three tonight.
When would this be implemented?
As soon as you approve it. We need drivers.
This may not be a thing, but when was the most recent bus driver hired?
I asked Kim and Michael that in regards to the last time we trained somebody, and it has not been since Kim has been here. It has been at least 3 years, and that's as far back as we tracked it.
We're good to go.
We gave up after 3 years of research.
A new bus driver. You hired at least one new bus driver last year.
But they had already received all of this from a prior district or a prior employment opportunity.
Are they required to stay with us for any certain amount of time?
They would be
beyond
with this.
Beyond 6 months? Not
no.
Beyond the 6 months, no.
That's an interesting question, what Ted brought up, that a new hire from a year or two ago was someone who already had the training. Would someone who came that already had the training still receive the sign-on bonus?
Yes.
Okay.
But would not be reimbursed.
But yes, would need the reimbursement.
Okay. A lot of good questions. Any others? Need a motion to approve the bus driver incentive.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Jenny and second by Sandy. Any other discussion? All in favor? Okay, motion carried 6-0. Thank you. Superintendent, business.
I have been alluding to Val and I spent about 3.5 or 4 hours today with RCTA, so I want to thank Val for her numbers and I believe in her help. And we believe that when we left the room, we had a win-win situation for both teachers as well as for the district as a whole, and those long-term plans that we've been talking about and growing the general fund and the accountability in that. I would like RCTA to have the opportunity to talk to teachers, and they plan on doing that Wednesday morning. They requested 5 minutes Wednesday morning during that PD time, and administrators are aware of that. We do have to have this uploaded or we reach a point of impasse by October 3rd, so I know we're under the gun and we'll need to call a special session, but I wanted to be very fair in regards to student enrollment numbers, and that count day was just on Friday, and we also wanted to make sure that we understood where we were with health insurance and how that played in. So that's why we're kind of under the gun here with dates. It's not because we pushed it off, it's because we wanted as much information as we could bring for both the district and the teachers to that meeting. So they anticipate talking to their association and ratifying this Wednesday, and I know that we need to post, but I would like us to consider a special session sometime next week to accept that collective bargaining agreement and to move forward so that we can post that to Gateway and finish that process.
Would you like to set the date today?
I would, because it'll take Julie and I posting, and RCTA would like to send a representative there just to share their viewpoint in regards to how that process went and their thoughts around the agreement.
You and Sandy and I will be gone Monday and Tuesday.
Correct. I have Wednesday, I meet with the superintendents just to share openly. Rural superintendents have been meeting with legislators and having those conversations, and they're as a group of local superintendents that's meeting Wednesday morning to continue to work on those conversations with legislators and determine next steps. In regards to that, we will not have legislators here that morning, but it's for us to determine what direction we need to head for next steps. But we should be done by 11 o'clock, so Wednesday I would have from 11 to 5:30.
You're talking the 28th, is that what you're talking about?
The 28th. Friday, we would have all afternoon and Friday evening, and then Monday's the last day to approve and
no pressure.
Upload it.
I could do Wednesday, but I can't do Friday.
Wednesday would have to be a daytime. I've been invited to Woodlawn for a rural health care insurance meeting Wednesday evening at Woodlawn that I feel is important for the district and for us to look at. So if we do Wednesday, it would have to be daytime.
Thursday evening, is that important?
Thursday evening, Terry Lee had invited superintendents to meet with community members out at the airport, and that's going to absorb about an hour's worth of time, so it would have to be before 5 o'clock or after probably 6:30 or 7.
Won't take long. It could be after that if that works for everybody. I mean, what's everybody else think part of their schedules?
The 29th.
That'd be the 29th.
I don't think I do Thursday.
I don't think I can do Thursday.
Okay, you can't Thursday. Okay.
Unless we do it during the day.
We can do it during the day.
I don't know if Steve can do it during the day. Probably not.
You're out totally on Thursday. Friday during the day?
Not daytime, no. We don't need all of us there.
That's true.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
four of us.
This is the thrilling part of the meeting.
Yeah, and I apologize. I know we're under the gun, but it was because in good faith, we wanted to bring as much data to the table as we could around student enrollment and insurance.
And what time on Wednesday would work?
On the 28th?
Yeah.
I could do it anytime from 11 until 5:30. Or then after 7:30 that evening. Woodlawn thought it would take about 90 minutes to 2 hour meeting.
I could do four o'clock
on Wednesday?
Five.
Well, that sounds everybody.
I'll have to be to Woodlawn by 5:30.
Oh. But you'll be back.
6 minute trip, 5 minutes if Brad gives you an escort.
4 minutes if I drive it in.
Okay, all right.
Actually, I'll have football practice, so it better be 5 minutes.
Okay. 5 o'clock on Wednesday, the 28th.
Okay.
On Wednesday.
Shouldn't be very long.
20 minutes.
Yeah.
Because you'll have the contract to us beforehand, so
exactly.
We have a chance.
Exactly.
Okay. Meeting here at the administration office.
Administration office, I think, will work. And it's a win-win. I think we all walked away from the table excited about the outcome. So Julie and I will work to post that Wednesday, the 28th at 5 o'clock. And our only topic will be the collective bargaining. Okay, thank you. And Ted, I'll get you copies of that tomorrow after we clean up today's language.
True.
Other than that, we had decided at our study session, we try once a quarter to have an evening study session so that those that may not have the opportunity to join us during the day could join us in the evening. So we're having an evening study session on October 17th at 6 p.m. And then just a general reminder, this week is homecoming, so we'd invite everybody out for the parade and activities prior to the football game. Those will begin at 6 o'clock with a 7 o'clock start time for our football game this Friday evening.
Bonfire Wednesday night?
I'm sorry?
Bonfire at the fairgrounds Wednesday night?
Thank you.
That's
typically where? It's typically Wednesday evening. I think last year was at the fairgrounds, maybe?
Yeah, it was.
I believe that's all I have.
Okay, thank you. Any other questions, discussions, comments from the board?
I would just like to thank Jason for his inviting us to tour their idea of paradise the other day. Yeah, it's really quite nice. A lot
Jason,
nicer
take you
than
to paradise anytime. Yeah, that's what I just heard.
Take you to paradise. That's right. So. Thank you for that.
I would like to acknowledge and thank our wonderful staff at the high school and even in other buildings during the past week and a half during the crisis. I think they were exemplary and we should be confident and proud in our school system.
Thank you. And the same goes for the community. I did not make a phone call that was turned down, and it didn't matter who we were calling or what needs we had. As soon as I made those phone calls, the community rallied as well, and I think that's a true indication of where we are for Rochester, not just Rochester schools, but Rochester. So thank you.
It's great to be in a community that when time comes, they need to pull together.
And they
do. They do, and they do it quickly and caringly and compassionately. So yes, thank you to everybody involved. Anything else? Anything from the audience?
And just very quickly, Valerie, thank you. She took, every time I had an idea, I think she probably cringed, but she took it. She just did a tremendous job of making sure she understood what I would like to see for the district and making sure it was in alignment with the board and the community is conveying to us in regards to overall financial responsibility. And I'm excited about what we're able to offer and know where we're going to go and what direction we're headed in. So thank you, Val. Even those 1:30 texts in the morning going back to work.
I hope you keep your phone in another room. Curbs the element of surprise.
Okay, well, thanks for everybody coming. We'll adjourn the meeting.
Nothing quite like getting a text.
Yeah.
More in the morning. It's like, don't you sleep?